You're listening to Christian Audio's production of People of the Second Chance, a guide to bringing life-saving love to the world, written and read by Mike Foster. This audio recording was produced in 2016 by Christian Audio, which owns the copyright. No portion of this recording may be reproduced for any reason without prior written consent from Christian Audio. This edition, recorded by arrangement with Waterbrook Press, an imprint of Crown Publishing Group, a division of Penguin Random House, LLC. Originally published in English as People of the Second Chance, copyright 2016 by Mike Foster. All rights reserved. Please visit christianaudio.com, facebook.com/christianaudio, or twitter.com/christianaudio to offer your impressions of this work and explore additional titles. Forward. Mike and I have been teaching a class at a local university together. It's a class about success and failure and what we do with each. Truthfully, we spend a lot more time in class talking about failure than success. The reason is simple. Our successes often distract us, while our failures usually shape us. Everyone wants to be successful. Whether you're a race car driver or a business leader or Olympian, you long to repeat your successes. Who doesn't? But not many people want to repeat a failure. Still, there are a handful of people who live their lives unafraid because they have come to realize the beauty in both success and failure. These people would rather fail trying than fail watching. Mike is one of those guys. Each week in class, we bring friends to talk about a time when they failed. In fact, experiencing failure has become almost a prerequisite to being our friend. Honestly, we wouldn't have much in common otherwise. We've noticed that people who have failed are more generous with their compassion, more extravagant with their love, and less inhibited in their expressions of both. I think it's because these people spend less time caring about what their lives look like and more time figuring out what their lives are about. I love Disneyland. On my first trip there as a kid, my family stayed at the Disneyland Hotel. I'd saved up my allowance for a year, and on the first day, I bought a stuffed animal with a really long, furry tail. That night, we went out on the balcony to watch the fireworks. I gave my stuffed animal the best seat in the house, up on the railing. When the fireworks ended, I tried to pick up my nylon friend, but it wouldn't move. Someone below had grabbed a hold of my stuffed animal's tail. I pulled up as hard as I could, and he pulled down as hard as he could. I didn't know what to do. It was the first time I ever felt as if something precious was about to be taken from me. This is an audiobook about love and hope and tugging back against those things that are trying to steal our joy, our attention, and our identities. All of us will have something that has been relentless in its tug on our lives. It may be a bad religious experience, our political stance, or the failures or successes we've experienced. This audiobook is about tugging back. It's an invitation with a little muscle behind it to see who God is turning us into, rather than over-identifying with who we were. This isn't a self-help audiobook about just being happy. It's about being aware of the beauty of becoming whole. It's not about finding meaning in our lives by looking perfect. Instead, it's about realizing that we are perfectly loved and allowing this to give our lives meaning. This is an audiobook for messed up overcomers, for religious rebels, for the broken but resilient. It's not about taking a knee in the end zone when you win, it's about taking both when you don't. Mike has created this grace-filled, shame-breaking audiobook by riffing on the lessons he's been learning from Jesus and has been incorporating in a nonprofit organization he founded for people who have messed up. It's aptly named People of the Second Chance. It's made of people like you and like me who are pulling against what's got us by the tail. If you feel as if you've lost your way and have asked the questions I've asked myself so many times, such as, who am I, or why am I here, or what in my life will outlast me, then this audiobook will be a heart-gripping, life-changing experience for you. This audiobook welcomes you into a community of second chancers who are discovering their true identity, their hopeful purpose, and the unfair advantage their failures have given them to impact others with big love rather than big opinions. Here's the simple truth. Life is messy. We don't need to act surprised anymore. Instead, we have reason to be tremendously hopeful. In the reverse economy of Jesus, the things that break us, God inverts to shape us. Either we can let those things pull us over the rail, or we can start pulling back. Fear, shame, and worthlessness have only the power we give them. This audiobook is about hope, love, and grace, and how they work toward the same ends. This audiobook was designed to remind us of our incredible stories. It's the voice of a man I trust whispering over our shoulders that our weirdness is wonderful and our quirks are among our most endearing qualities. Most important, this audiobook reminds us that God is just moments away from transforming the shame and fear we've allowed to pull us over the rails into a right perspective about self-acceptance, love, and faith. I'm proud to introduce to you my friend Mike Foster and the safe place he's made in this audiobook for all of us to learn, grow, and explore our successes and our failures. This is what Mike calls people of the second chance. You're already accepted and loved, and you've only just arrived. That's because there's nothing to prove, nothing to be except you, and everything to imagine. This is a place where the dream God has placed in your heart isn't limited by the failures you've encountered in getting here. Welcome home. Bob Goff, chief balloon inflator and New York Times bestselling author of Love Does. Introduction. 3 seconds. People of the second chance live in the humble arrogance of being God's beloved. I am a second chancer, and it only took 3 seconds of my life to make me long for that role. It was a Memorial Day weekend on the Colorado River, and I was 19 years old. I joined some families from church who were doing their annual water ski trip. The Rogers and McGregor families put on a water skiing extravaganza each year and invited a few friends. I got to be a chosen friend that year. We woke early the first morning and water skied for a few hours. Everyone fared well except for me, a newbie. When I skied, I looked more like a drunk giraffe than a muscle-bound water aficionado. I gave it my best shot, but I'm certain I swallowed more water than I skied on. Everyone on the boat played cool about my tragic shortcomings in the ski department. No flat-out mocking, just some heavy sighing and huffing with a dash of disdain. My pride was bruised, but I kept up a good image. I've always been good at image managing and pretending to be okay. I learned early on that it's best to be strong and smile your way through subpar performances. Nothing to see here, folks. I'm fine. No weakness at all. None. Let's just move along. Furthermore, I couldn't let any of those girls in Christian bikinis know I wasn't potential boyfriend material. Know what I mean? Ryan McGregor, my friend who invited me on the trip, sensed my ego had been bumped around a little. He figured it would be good for me to give boat driving a shot. I could redeem my honor and build up what was left of my bruised ego. I needed a second chance. So Ryan asked, "Hey Mike, you want to drive the boat?" I honestly thought, how hard could this boat driving thing be? It's got a steering wheel. I know how to do steering wheels. I said, "Sure, Ryan, count me in." He explained that he would get the boat going. There's an art to pulling a skier out of the water, and as a rookie driver, I wasn't quite ready for that. We started cruising up the river. John, our skier, zipped back and forth behind the boat. He skied like a graceful water gazelle, lightly jumping from one wave to another, so unlike the intoxicated giraffe style I had demonstrated earlier that morning. The warm wind blew in our faces. I felt alive. Ryan gave me the look and said, "Okie dokie, Mike, your turn." He scooted away from the wheel and pointed for me to take over. I did. Now I was driving, studly as can be. I was good with steering wheels. I hoped those Christian girls were noticing. After a few moments, our skier motioned that he wanted to turn around and go the other way. Ryan said, "Okay, Mike, we need to turn the boat and go back down the river. Just turn the wheel slowly and evenly, and you should be good to go." So I began to turn the wheel and drive the boat into what I thought was clear water. But it wasn't clear water. There was a skier from another boat in my path. He had dropped into the water, waiting for his boat to pick him up. I didn't see him until it was too late. I couldn't turn our boat in time. And I hit him. It happened in just 3 seconds, yet it felt like an eternity. Ryan quickly cut the engines and dove into the water and swam toward the skier I had just hit. The skier's head flopped forward. His body bobbed on the water like a rag doll. A pool of red blood surrounded him. His life was draining into the water. Panic. Fear. The Christian girls were now screaming, and I just wanted to run. Run as far and fast as I could from what I had done. Run from myself. Run from life. Run from what everyone was now thinking. Run from the fact that there was no going back, no undoing this, no repairing the damage, just me facing a motionless, bloody body in the river. I wanted to escape. Maybe you've been there too. The skier survived. The doctors weren't sure how he survived, but he did. He lost a ton of blood. The propeller had snapped off and hit him in the head. The blade carved up his right arm. It was a miracle he was alive. The doctor said if the propeller had struck just a quarter of an inch deeper, the force would have decapitated him. That thought still gives me shivers. My victim spent weeks in the hospital. After the accident, I was lost. I didn't know what to say. I didn't know how to act. How sad or strong are you supposed to be? There is no playbook for such tragedies. Should I be grateful that he lived or regret the incredible damage I did? Do I talk about it or just keep quiet? Is there a Bible verse to hang on to? What should I feel? These are questions I later learned that only grace could answer. Meanwhile, my heart was dead. I felt alone and my thoughts were dark. My words stuck inside me, trapped in a story I desperately wanted to escape. The damage I did that day on the river was real. It rippled through families, friends, and innocent bystanders. I would never forget, but they couldn't either. Even though it was an unintentional accident, I still blame myself. I took all the responsibility for that day. I shamed myself hard in the weeks and months that followed. The district attorney pressed criminal charges. A lawsuit followed. But none of that compared to my self-imposed punishment. And out of this tragedy, I created a new rule for my life. Even though I loved being in, on, and around the water, it was now off limits to me. I carved this final verdict on my heart so I would never, ever forget. The water was now closed to me. I told myself this would honor my victim. I also convinced myself this was the best way to protect my heart from having those feelings again. The new rule would work so well. It all made perfect sense until it didn't. Because that rule, meant to crush my shame and protect my heart, instead crushed me. I wrote it to protect myself, but I ended up punishing myself, pinning myself down to a small, groveling life. I couldn't take the chance of stirring any more troubles on the waters of my story. I became small and I played it safe. Such rules and laws, it was like making a deal with the devil, no more sorrow at the cost of no joy. And that's the problem, isn't it? Grace gets censored when we write these devilish decrees for our lives. Secret commandments get scrawled on personal tablets of shame, and we live life as if our stories belong on a discount rack rather than as valued, cherished children of God. We let a moment of pain cut us off from a lifetime of grace. The rules we write for ourselves are sneaky. They run quietly in the background like a virus infecting an operating system. We forget that they are even there. They intertwine their devious codes throughout our spiritual, emotional, and psychological systems. I call them the five condemnments. Number one, I don't deserve a second chance. Number two, I am my shame. I am my secrets. Number three, I will always feel and be this way. Number four, I am defined by my worst moments. Number five, my life, my dreams, my hopes no longer matter. And this is what we need to talk about, isn't it? We need to look at what's running the background of our beliefs and expose the shame virus corrupting our hope for a better life. We must come out of the shadows and talk about hard things. Reaching back. When I am working with hurting people, probably the most tragic thing I witness is when they have accepted the lie that whatever ugly, can't talk about it, embarrassing thing has happened in their stories is somehow beyond the grace of God. That His mercy doesn't reach far enough. that his hand of grace is just beyond the quiet addiction to painkillers, the shame of an unexpected divorce from the person you love so much, someone's sexuality and what it all means, the betrayal of a family member, the fear of growing old and being alone. God's reach is just beyond a secret abortion and the sorrows of miscarriages, the depression, the sadness, and the eating disorder, the drinking and the bad choices, hidden regrets that you chose your career instead of your kids. Yet God is reaching out in all these painful moments and whispers, "Just reach back to me, my beloved. I am here. Please, I beg you, just reach back." In preparing to record this audiobook, I thought about you a lot, about what your life might look like right now. Where do you live? What hurts do you carry? Do you like yourself? What beliefs do you have? Whom do you love? Who loves you? What lies do you believe? What friends do you have? Do you know the lavish grace of God? I wondered why you might pick up an audiobook about second chances. Were you looking for a chance to change, a chance to thrive, a chance to be challenged, a chance to start over, a chance to forgive, a chance to dream wild dreams? Or maybe you're looking for a chance to be loved as you've never been loved before. And wouldn't that be wonderful? Because to be loved like that is what you were made for. It's the reason you and I are here. It's what we are all looking for. And that, my friend, is the place we must start. There are two ideas that I will talk about in this audiobook. They are the foundation for what I believe it means to live as people of the second chance. They are values on which I try to base my own life, and I have found that if we embrace them, they will take us into the house of grace and belonging. Fundamentally, this audiobook rests on answering these questions that every human being has asked thousands of times. Who am I? What am I here for? There are many answers to these two questions. Countless gurus, parents, religious leaders, motivational speakers, infomercial pitchmen, and those who are trying to sell something for three easy payments of $19.99 seem to have an answer for you. But let me be bold for a moment. Let me take a stab at answering those most basic human questions the best way I know how. Let me answer through the lens of God's love and what I know of my own brokenness. The humble arrogance of being His beloved. My simplistic answer to the question, who am I, is this. My truest, purest, non-negotiable identity is the beloved. And in spite of my checkered past, my fabulous flops, my painful history, my deepest flaws, my bonehead screw-ups, and yes, even beyond my own beliefs about myself, I am God's beloved. This is my foundational identity and the foundational identity of every human being. I am not those 3 seconds on the Colorado River. You are not your failures. And just because we have made mistakes doesn't mean we are mistakes. Every other self-concept is a jumbled concoction of our fears, insecurities, and hurtful words spoken over our lives. Define yourself radically as one beloved by God, said Brennan Manning. This is the true self. Every other identity is illusion. Identity is the engine that drives the relationship not only with ourselves, but also with God and others. If your identity is broken, your life is broken. If you define it incorrectly, you will carry that wrong definition into your story. If all you see are your limitations, you'll miss out on the stunning possibilities God is creating in front of you. I've heard it said that the only thing needed for a powerful lion to be intimidated by a person with a whip is for the lion to forget who he is. If the lion forgets he is a lion, he is doomed to a life of controlled captivity. Your beliefs about who you are have more power than you likely realize. Think about this. You can never, and I mean never, live above your self-imposed limitations. If you think you can't do something, you can't and never will. Period. You won't rise above your own negative self-image. Let me share an example. On the first day of school in an after-school program, the predominantly African-American children in Oakland, California hear something none of them has ever heard before. they learned that the word Africa wasn't always spelled A-F-R-I-C-A, but earlier it was spelled A-F-R-A-C-A. The children are asked to speculate why it might have changed and whether it matters. They shrug their shoulders as if to say, "Who knows? After all, what difference can one letter make?" The teacher then explains that the syllable frick can be traced back to an Arab word meaning land of the conquered or vanquished, but the syllable frack goes back to a term that means land of the hidden soul. The teacher asks again, "Do you think it matters? For someone with African heritage, one letter is the difference between seeing oneself as a vanquished victim or a descendant of humanity's hidden soul." That's how these kids in Oakland begin a year of life-changing lessons, not just in history and colonialism, but also in empowerment and identity. It's too soon to draw conclusions, but so far, all the children who have gone through this year-long after-school program are showing high levels of engagement in their learning and significant academic improvement. What if you changed a letter in your identity? Could a few tweaks in who you think you are be the beginning of a whole new story? Could identity hold the key to letting hope and healing rush in? Could stepping away from stinking thinking radically change the way you see yourself and your role in the world? I think it will. It's time to stop seeing yourself as an inhabitant in the land of the conquered and vanquished. That's not you. You are from the land of the hidden soul. You are not made to live under the weight of religion or guilt or chronic not enoughness. You are made to enjoy the love of God. His heart is far larger, His love far stronger than anything we can imagine. A relationship with Him is not a relationship between equals. He runs the show. He initiates. He works. He finishes. That's scary. God is one lover you cannot manipulate or woo. He's all one-sided. It's all grace, and He is all love. Party planners. So if the starting point of second chance living is knowing who we are, then the next step is knowing what we are to be about. Franciscan priest Richard Rohr says, when you get your "who am I" question right, all the "what should I do" questions tend to take care of themselves. It is so easy to complain about the state of the world: violence, selfishness, economic injustice, racism, sexism, systemic oppression. The reality is, bombs, bureaucracies, and political parties will not solve society's greatest problems. Only you and I can solve them, and we can do it with subversive acts of love. That means you and I must believe again in the world, in ourselves, and in each other. I love what author Howard Zinn wrote in his essay, "The Optimism of Uncertainty." If we see only the worst, it destroys our capacity to do something. If we remember those times and places, and there are so many, where people have behaved magnificently, this gives us the energy to act and at least the possibility of sending the spinning top of a world in a different direction. And if we do act, in however small a way, we don't have to wait for some grand utopian future. The future is an infinite succession of presents, and to live now as we think human beings should live, in defiance of all that is bad around us, is itself a marvelous victory. So how do we respond to being the beloved? What will our hours, days, and lifetimes be filled with as we sink deeper and deeper into the knowledge of His love? Or as the poet Mary Oliver asked, "Tell me, what is it you plan to do with your one wild and precious life?" The response to God's love is before us. I think it is clear, but we often miss it. I see God as someone who loves to play, dream, and create. He is the one who hung sparkling stars in the night sky and paints masterpiece sunsets each evening. I see God as a friend who smiles and laughs and likes cupcakes and chocolate icing. He is the life and the God of the party. I love how the scriptures point out that Jesus himself was so prone to have a good time that he was accused of being a glutton and a drunkard. Matthew chapter 11, verse 19. Or consider the clearest picture of God's grace in the parable of the prodigal son. The whole point of the gospel comes through a story about a wayward child who returns home to a raging party thrown in his honor. Given by whom? The Father, who clearly represents God. The Creator celebrates broken things as a way to love us. And this, my friend, is also what he invites us to do. Yet too often we miss this part, haven't we? Sometimes we see the sin, but forget about the celebration. We lick our wounds, but never a tasty sprinkled cupcake. Instead of prodigal parties with reggae music and fruit punch, we throw pity parties that no one wants to attend. We've grown so victimized by our own hurting that we've missed celebrating the miracle of our healing. And not only our own healing, but also the healing of those around us. Second chancers must find the party. We must be the party. We must create opportunities to celebrate and become the proverbial hostess with the mostess. What I am proposing is that you and I do the work of prodigal party planning, that we figure out creative ways to celebrate the uncelebrated people in our cities, that we look at our fellow prodigals and say, yeah, we've been there too. It hurts. It stinks. But you're loved, and here's a cupcake. The formula could look like this. People of the second chance become planners of the second chance, the beloved who adopt the sole purpose and mission to love. Get your address book out. Open up your Google contacts. Look around you. Send out invitations to misfits and outsiders, single moms and welfare dads, enemies and friends, haters and lovers, ex-cons and crack dealers, Walmart greeters and Rolex-wearing CEOs, dreamers, doubters, and everyone in between. Let's just say that everyone gets an invite and no one gets left out. Mother Teresa said, "The problem with the world is that we draw the circle of our family too small. When we plan parties, we should draw big circles because we are all family and everyone needs a party." Imagine what our faith might look like if we partied as much as we preached, if we spent as much time blowing up balloons as we do attending Bible studies. What might happen if our mission were to serve as much cheese dip to crazies as we do communion to churchgoers? It is time to enjoy God again. Yes, there is suffering, but there is also celebration. Yes, there is pain, but there is also a party. Your life will be heavy, and it will be light. The question is, how will you carry it, and what will you do with it? A friend told me that the exact same place can be either a prison or a promised land. The difference is perspective, and the fact that you must work to make where you are where you want to be. Looking back on my boating accident, I know I could have used a prodigal party. I needed something to free me from the prison where my heart was being held. Someone sharing some chips and salsa with me would have been my miracle. I needed God's beloved to let me know the Father still delighted in me. I eventually forgave myself, and in recognition of this, let myself enjoy the water again, but it took many years. People need to know that after the tragic pain, the irreplaceable loss, the death of our dreams, reputations, innocence, and health, after battling the storms of addiction, betrayal, and boat accidents, after we've messed up, fallen flat on our faces, and tasted the bitter pill of our own powerlessness, after all of this, we can smile again. The American diplomat John Kenneth Galbraith said, "All successful revolutions are the kicking in of a rotten door." I want this audiobook to be a big boot and the systems of shame, cynicism, hopelessness, judgment, captivity, and oppression to be the rotten door. The tragedy of my boating accident and my other rock bottom experiences have taught me many lessons about what it means to live as a second chancer. This is the journey I want to take you on. I've seen the power of believing in broken people. I've discovered that the only thing I have to be is God's beloved. I am not those 3 seconds, and with the God of grace by my side, I'm ready to kick down the rotten door. Chapter 1. Green Coats. People of the second chance hold to the promise that broken things can be made beautiful again. Whether we like it or not, our experience is one part mischief, one part miracle, and one part mayhem, all slammed together to make this cocktail called life. Our second chance stories can look very different from one another, and yet are often similar. Life demands that you and I sit in the tension of pain and suffering. One of the first steps of living as a second chancer is to get comfortable with our messes, to find a peace with who we are and what life turned into for us. I've sat with so many people who have struggled with the sorrow of their stories, whose expectations did not line up with how life had turned out. They wanted an outcome that was never promised. My simple advice to them, embrace it all. Every tear and every heartbreak, every stain and every scab, every flaw and every imperfection, they belong to you, I say, so wear them with your head held high. Second chancers understand our brokenness isn't something to hide, but to integrate into our lives. We do not need to be ashamed. No matter what the world says, we are not less than for being broken. And yet it is so tempting to have it all together, isn't it? To look so good and be so fine. The right clothes, the right brands, sexy Instagram photos where we look thin and young, our perfect kids winning Student of the Month awards, pictures of our summer vacations that are better than everyone else's summer vacations. Fat girls want to be skinny girls and skinny guys want to be beefier guys. We nip and tuck and Photoshop almost every aspect of our lives. It is the perfection playbook. God's desire is to unleash you and me from the pathological desire to look nice. He says, whoever you are, whatever you look like, whatever mess you've been in, don't worry about that anymore. You're mine, and you're in good hands now. He meets us when our faces are smudged with last night's sin. In the stink of old cigarettes, cheap booze, and the pine saw we use to clean our vomit off the floor, He is there in our shame and self-hatred. He meets us in the middle of our secrets, those things we lie about when we say they are no big deal. My fellow second chancers, I know we all want to look good, but we're not meant to look that good. The grace movement is built on imperfection and scraggly edges. Without stains and scars, hope is an afterthought, a luxury instead of a necessity. Without our imperfections, there is nothing to place in the hands of God. We are all green coats. In 1955, a woman named Elizabeth Henson was cleaning out her wardrobe closet. She felt it was time to discard some items that were old or that she didn't wear anymore.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.